Dear students, you are aware of the great revolt that took place in 1857. So that is also known as the First War of Indian Independence. But many students do not know the fact that even before the great revolt of 1857, there have been many large scale attempts, though unsuccessful, to uproot the British Raj. So let us see all the prominent revolts that took place before that great revolt of 1857, because the British have already transformed themselves into more or less a government after the Battle of Plassey, and the great revolt took place in 1857. So during these 100 years, many attempts have been made from different sections of the society, from different parts of the country, to overthrow the British administrative setup. So let's have a look at the prominent revolts. So the revolt of 1857 was a major upheaval against the British, needless to say. So however, it is important to note that this was not the first time that common people of India had revolted against the British. Right from the inception of East India Company, there had been resistance from divergent sections of Indian society. So, even before the revolt of 1857, many different sections of the society from different parts of the country, they have attempted to overthrow. So, let's have a look at all these now. So, these disturbances and uprisings, though, did not succeed in uprooting the British power, but they were the precursors of the major revolt of 1857. So they acted like forerunners of the, or you can say they inspired people of India for the great revolt of 1857. So before we take up the study of the revolt of 1857 in detail, so let's have a look at the prominent such, you know, revolts which have occurred prior to that. So let's see. So when we will see these revolts, the most important things that you have to take care is that at which location, which part of the country these revolts took place in, what was the reason and what was the outcome and who were the leaders. So the first such revolt was Sanyasi and Fakir rebellion. So who are Sanyasis? So, Sanyasis were the 10 Nami Naga Sadhus of North India who used to visit various shrines of Bengal. So, during that time, even today, people from different parts of the country visit all the shrines, you know, people of India, they keep on visiting different parts of the country in an attempt to visit their holy shrines. So, during the British era, the Dasnami Sadhus also used to visit Bengal because Bengal had many Hindu religious shrines. The other group, because this is Sanyasi and Fakir rebellion. So two group of people had come together. So first group was of Sanyasis. So who were these Sanyasis? They were basically Dasnami Naga Sadhus. The other group was of Madariya Fakirs of Sufi Silsila of Bengal. Okay? So, Madariya Fakirs, the second group. From 1760s onwards, the Sanyasi revolt had engulfed the area of Bengal Suba. So, you understand that Bengal of that time is today's Bangladesh, Bihar, Odisha included. So this is important fact that how do we know about these rebellions in detail. So there is a famous Indian novel, Anand Math. So Anand Math, written by the great novelist Bankim Chandra Chatterjee. He is often known as India's first modern novelist. So it is his novel that talks in great detail about this rebellion, Sanyasi Fakir rebellion. Also noteworthy is the fact that our national song Vande Mataram. So Vande Mataram is taken from this novel. So Vande Mataram is our national song, whereas national anthem is Jana Gana Mana. So understand the difference between national song एंड एंदम. सो दीज टू रिलीजियस ग्रुप विच ग्रुप्स सन्यासीज एंड फकीर्स. सो दीज टू रिलीजियस ग्रुप्स indulged in money lending business and also took religious tax from the nawabs and zamindars. So these were religious people. They were not farmers. They were not businessmen. So how did they earn money? So they actually used to charge some religious taxes from rich people and kings, princes, nawabs, zamindars, like that. And they used to distribute or invest that money in money lending business. So basically, these sadhus were of North India and they used to visit Bengal. So when they used to enter Bengal, they used to distribute money. And while returning, they used to collect their money along with tax. So this was the basic money lending business. So what happened? When Britishers took over Bengal, so they acquired the Diwani rights. So if they have the Diwani rights, it means only the British could collect tax, any form of tax. So they said that how can sannyasis and fakirs collect taxes, or how can they lend money without the permission of the company? So EIC declared this money lending and religious tax as criminal activity. They also tried to put other restrictions on the religiously minded people and accused them of plotting against the British Raj, because these sannyasis and fakirs, they used to do large mass gatherings, they used to give speeches and all that. So British thought that these sannyasis and fakir, they are provoking common masses to revolt against the British Raj. So these sannyasis retaliated by organizing raids on companies, factories and state treasuries. So only after a prolonged military action could Warren Hastings. So Warren Hastings was the Governor General of Bengal when this revolt broke out. So Warren Hastings contained the revolt raid by the sannyasis. So this was about sannyasis. So Bhavani Pathak. So who were the leaders of the revolt? So Bhavani Pathak was a Robin Hood like dacoit. Robin Hood like, that means she used to help the poor. She used to do robbery on rich people and she used to give money to the poor people. So Bhavani Pathak was a Robin Hood like dacoit and she was the leader of sannyasi movement in West Bengal. So you have to remember who were the leaders. Who were the leaders and where did it take place? So Bhavani Pathak, Devi Chaudhrani led the sannyasis after killing of Bhavani Pathak. So Bhavani Pathak was killed by the British government. After she died, her follower Devi Chaudhrani continued the movement. So this was from Hindu's side, sannyasis side. What about the fakirs? For fakirs, Majnu Shah was the main leader. This guy Majnu Shah was the main leader. He was killed and after his death, his brother Musa Shah took the leadership and continued rebel for some time. So basically you have to remember Majnu Shah, Devi Chaudhrani and Bhavani Pathak as the leaders of this revolt. The next prominent revolt was Poligar revolt and it took place for 3 continuous years. It basically started in 1799. Who were the Poligars? So Poligars were the feudal lords, you can say zamindars, who were appointed as military chiefs and administrative governors from the time of Vijayanagar Empire. It was the Poligars who collected taxes from the cultivators. So Poligars were appointed from the time of Vijayanagar kingdom. So what they were acting like zamindars, they were collecting taxes from common farmers. So what went wrong? So but the East India Company declared that Poligars could not collect revenue. Again, the same problem, money. So now Britishers thought that only and only they can collect taxes and revenues. So if anybody else will try to collect taxes and revenue, So he will be termed as criminal. So that's why polygons were asked to stop. They were said that now you cannot collect tax. So that's why these Jamindars or polygons, they revolted. So the first polygon war broke out in September of 1719 in Tirunelveli district of Tamil Nadu, of today's Tamil Nadu. So if somebody asks where did the polygon revolt took place, you have to say Tamil Nadu or Tirunelveli district. Who was the leader? The polygons were led by Kattabomma Nayak. So Kattabomma Nayak fought for 7 years, but he was eventually caught and he was hanged in public. So it took British more than a year to suppress this rebellion. So the suppression, after these polygons were defeated, the British signed a treaty known as Carnatic Treaty. So after signing of this treaty, the British took over the control of Tamil Nadu. So you have to remember, this polygon revolt have taken place in today's Tamil Nadu. The polygon system, which had flourished for over 2.5 centuries, came to a violent end, and the company introduced the Jamindari settlement. So Jamindari settlement, just like they have done in 1793, they have already done this in Bengal. Now they have acquired Tamil Nadu also. So Tamil Nadu have been acquired after signing of Carnatic Treaty. The next prominent was Chuar Revolt of 1799. The term Char or Chuar was used for local tribals in Bengal, and it was a derogatory word which meant pig. So it was like insulting for the tribals of Bengal. So these tribals, they faced so many other problems, like there were famines, there were increase in taxes, and they were also insulted and exploited by the British government. So because of these tribal people revolted. So Chuar revolt, where is this taking place? So this took place in Bankura district of Bengal. Who was the leader? Leader was Durjan Singh. So these are key points that you have to remember. Rest you can read. So leaders from this revolt was Durjan Singh, who was removed from his position of Raipur Pargana of Bankura district of Bengal. So what did Durjan Singh do? So Durjan Singh, along with his 1500 followers, mostly Chuars means tribal farmers. So he had gathered these many followers. So they snatched or they took control of 30 villages and they started attacking East India Company. But the Britishers were able to suppress the rebellion with utmost cruelty. So around 200 rebels were executed in the process. So main things to remember from here is, who is the leader, where is the revolt taking place, what is the reason. The next important revolt is Paika revolt, leader Baksi Jagbandhu. The Pike or Paika rebellion, as it is called, was an armed rebellion against the British East India Company's rule in Odisha. So where did Paika revolt take place? In Odisha. Who was the leader? Baksi Jagbandhu. Who were these Paikas? So Paikas were the peasant soldiers, again farmers who were also soldiers, peasant soldiers of the Gajpati rulers of Odisha, who rendered military service to the king during times of war. That means they were basically farmers, but whenever there was a call from their king or whenever Odisha was going to a war, so these farmers, they became soldiers. So they were soldiers also and they were farmers also. So these farmers, soldiers, were subjected to taxes. See, please understand, before the British took control, they were not paying any kind of taxes. But now all of a sudden they are asked to pay tax. That was the main reason for many of the revolts. So they were also subjected to taxes and oppression at the hands of the British. So Bakshi Jagbandhu Vidyadhar, the Paika leader, started a revolt in 1817. The Paikas attacked British police station, administrative offices and the treasury, and British fled during their march towards Khurda. So you need not remember all this, but as a teacher, I will have to tell you. So main things that you have to remember: where did the revolt took place? Who were the leaders? Rest everything is same. They are obviously going to attack British, and British is going to suppress them. That's why they are not successful. So main things: where did the revolt took place? Who is the leader? And what is the year? So Paikas, however, fought guerrilla warfare against the British, yet the revolt was completely suppressed by 1819. Therefore, it lasted for a year and a half. So Bakshi Jagbandhu surrendered to the British in 1825 and lived as a prisoner in Cuttack till his death in 1829. The next important revolt was Wahhabi movement, which is also known as Wahhabi Jihad. So what was this Wahhabi movement? The Wahhabi movement was founded by Sayyid Ahmad Barelvi of Rai Bareli. So he was a Muslim cleric. He was a Muslim fanatic cleric. So Wahhabi movement basically was a call given to the Muslims that after the advent of British rule and European culture, Islam has suffered, or people following the religion of Islam, they have come under Western influence. So it was basically an attempt to revive Islam. So it was an Islamic revivalist movement, which was influenced by the teachings of Abdul Wahhab. Wahhab, that's why Wahhabi. So Abdul Wahhab was a philosopher of Arabia, and based on his teaching, Sayyid Ahmad Barelvi, who was a Muslim cleric of Rai Bareli, that's why Barelvi. So he started a new movement in India based on the teachings of Abdul Wahhab. So Sayyid Ahmad gave a call to return back to pure Islam, give up Western influence. So this movement had its important centers at Patna, with its missions situated in other parts such as Hyderabad, Madras, United Province, means today's Uttar Pradesh, UP, that time also it was UP only, and Bombay. But the main storm center of Wahhabi movement was actually Punjab. So main, all the events during the Wahhabi movement have taken place in Punjab. Let's see. So Barelvi, Sayyid Ahmad Barelvi, wanted to convert the kafirs. Who are kafirs? Anyone who does not believe in Islam. So basically non-Muslims. So he wanted to convert the non-Muslims to Muslims. So that's why this is known as jihad. And he was a religious bigot fanatic. So he declared a jihad against the Sikh kingdom of Punjab. Who declared? Sayyid Ahmad Barelvi. Sayyid Ahmad was killed by Sikhs in Battle of Balakot in 1831. Fine. Once the British took control of Punjab, the English rule became the sole target of the Wahhabis in India. So earlier their aim was to purify Islam, to try to convert people from other religion into Islam. But once the British consolidated their power in Punjab, so instead of, they forgot their rivalries with Sikh and they started attacking the English rule, because they did not want the Western people to cause damage to the rule of Islam. They played a significant role in spread of anti-British sentiment among the Muslims. So you have to remember a few things. Who started this Wahhabi movement? Sayyid Ahmad Barelvi. How did he die? He died at Battle of Balakot. He was killed by the Sikh military. So these Wahhabis, they have also participated in the revolt of 1857 because they did not like British rule. They had great anti-British sentiments filled with in them. The next important revolt is Ramozi Rising. Who were the Ramozis? The Ramozis were the hill tribes of Western Ghat. Western Ghat means Maharashtra, basically region of Pune to Mumbai, that built. So the Ramozis, the hill tribes of Western Ghat, had not reconciled to British rule. That means they have not become accustomed to British rule and British administration. So they rose against Chittoor Singh because tribals thought that British rule is threat to their culture and their independence. So they rose under Chittoor Singh. Important. Who is the leader? Chittoor Singh is the leader. In 1822, and plundered the country around Satara. So these tribal people, to teach the Britishers a lesson, they started attacking them. So again, there were eruptions in 1825-26 and the disturbances continued till 1829. So basically, where did this Ramozi Rising take place? Western Ghat, to be precise, in Satara, Maharashtra. Who was the leader? Chittoor Singh was the leader. So this disturbance occurred again in 1839 over deposition and banishment of Raja Pratap Singh of Satara. And because when the king of Satara was removed, you remember Satara was annexed. Doctrine of lapse. So when Satara was annexed by Britishers, again these tribal people created this revolt. So this revolt have occurred for at least 2 to 3 times. So all these 2-3 different events are together known as Ramozi uprising. Where was this happening? So basically near and around the district of Satara, Maharashtra. The next important revolt was the Pagalpanthi revolt. So this revolt developed in the Sherpur province of East Bengal, which is today known as Bangladesh. So where did this revolt took place? You can say Bengal. You can have any option. You can have Bengal. You can have Sherpur. So it depends. Or you can have East Bengal. So who were these Pagalpanthis? So Pagalpanthis were a religious sect equally devoted to Hinduism and Sufism. So these Pagalpanthis, they used to carry arm and they were equally devoted to Hinduism and Islam. They became prominent in East Bengal, which is today's Bangladesh. Who was the leader? Their leader was Karam Shah. The sect was founded by Karam Shah and was later led by his son Tipu. Pagalpanthis stood up against oppressive taxes and laws imposed by the Jamindars and the British. The revolt started at around 1825. The rebels kept disturbed the area for more than 25 years. Because you remember that Karam Shah started it, but it was continued by his son. So this revolt continued for 25 years. Karam Shah and Tipu Shah. So Tipu Shah finally died in 1852. And after his death, the revolt was suppressed by the army. The next important revolt was Kol Mutiny. Kol was a tribe, name of a tribe living in Jharkhand, Bengal region. So today's Jharkhand, that time there was no Jharkhand. The Kols were one of the tribes inhabiting the Chota Nagpur area. So Chota Nagpur was part of Bengal Suba. So in today's term, it is the Bengal-Jharkhand border region. Their autonomy, or you can say independence, and traditional tribal administration was affected by British Raj. The Kols fell into the trap of taxes and money lenders who had the backing of the British. So there was a revolt in 1831-32 by the Koles of Singhbhum. So where did this revolt take place? Singhbhum. So Singhbhum is near Jamshedpur, or you can say Jamshedpur of modern India, Jamshedpur, Jharkhand. So there was a revolt by Koles of Singhbhum against the British and the money lenders. They killed many outsiders and burned houses. So this revolt was not only against the British people, but it was also against the money lenders. Why? Because these poor tribal people, they have been trapped by money lenders. They have to pay taxes. They could not feed their family. So they used to take loans. And these people or these money lenders used to take everything from them if they could not pay back the loan. So this revolt was not only against the British, it was also against Indian zamindars and money lenders. So they killed many outsiders and burned houses. So this armed resistance went on for 2 years after. The revolt was brutally suppressed by British with the help of army units of Calcutta and Banaras. The next important revolt was the Mopla revolt of 1836. The Mopla rebellions of Malabar, South India, were not only directed against British but also Hindu landlords. Many of the Arab traders settled in Malabar, marrying local Malayali females. So their descendants came to be known as Mopla. So who were these Mopla people? So they were basically the descendants of Arabs, and they were born out of marriage between these Arab people and local Malayali females. So they were followers of Islam. So these peasants were mostly the Muslim Moplas. During the reign of Haider Ali and Tipu Sultan, Nambudri Brahmins and Nair landlords had to flee from Malabar, and their land was taken over by Moplas. So there was religious communal tension during the time of Tipu Sultan and Haider Ali. So Moplas were Muslims, whereas majority of landlords were Brahmins. So communal tension had taken place, and taking advantage of that, these Moplas have caused these landlords, Hindu landlords, to flee from Malabar, and they have taken over the lands of their Hindu zamindars. But after Tipu's death, and British re-established these Hindu landlords. So these lands actually belong to Hindu landlords, but Moplas have fought with them and have forced them to flee. But now Tipu Sultan is dead. So British told these Hindu landlords that go back to your land and become zamindars again. So by this, the British angered the Moplas, because Moplas had become the zamindar now, but now British are sending back the Hindu landlords. So Moplas were again reduced to the status of tenants, that means farmers, leaseholders, farmers who lived on that land, more like tenant. So Mopla peasantry rose up in revolt. The first outbreak occurred in 1836, and thousands of British officials and Hindu zamindars were massacred. They were killed in cold blood by these Moplas. So it was a communal revolt. Question is asked, which of these is communal revolt? Communal revolt means not only against British, but it also involved the fighting of Hindu and Muslims. There was another Mopla revolt in 1921, which was a branch of Khilafat movement that engulfed Malabar. So this Mopla that we are talking about has happened in 1836. At the same place, these same people, these Moplas, again in 1921, they did another revolt against their Hindu zamindars, but that was more of a branch of Khilafat movement, because during that time, All the Muslims of the country were participating in Khilafat movement, which took place between 1920 and 22. So during that time also, these same Muplas did the same thing. They again killed the Hindu Jamindars. So this is not actually a revolt. You can say this was more like a Hindu-Muslim riot. But since the British were also killed, so it is thought of a revolt. The next important is Kuka revolt. So the movement was began in 1840. Who is the leader? Bhagat Jawahar Mal, who is also known as Saiya Sahib. And this took place in Punjab, West Punjab. The movement aimed to purify Sikhism by abolition of castes, discrimination, and giving up eating meat and alcohol. The Kuka movement started as a religious movement, though it later began to acquire political overtone. So what was the original purpose of Kuka movement? To purify the religion of Sikhism. So to advocate good things about Sikhism, like do not practice violence, give up smoking, drinking, do not eat non-vegetarian. But very soon it acquired political overtone. Acquired political overtone, that means from the domain of religion, it entered the domain of resistance against the British. So soon the movement began to focus on achieving Sikh freedom from British Raj. So if you want freedom, you have to take it from British, because British have captured Punjab. So in order to purify Sikhism, they have to have their own Sikh kingdom. That is possible only if they overthrow British Raj. So Kuka movement turned into a revolt against the British Raj. So the British followed extremely repressive measures from 1862 to 1872 to suppress the movement. The next important is Gadkari and Sawantwadi revolt, which took place in 1844. So who are the Gadkaris? The Gadkaris were a hereditary military class who were in charge of safeguarding Maratha forts. They were removed from their services by Kolhapur state in 1844. So where did this revolt took place? This revolt took place in regions of Maharashtra, prominently Kolhapur. So these Gadkaris, they were actually in charge of, you see, when we were discussing the kingdoms of the Marathas, so Marathas were fond of building dozens and dozens of forts. So if you build fort, you also need people to take care of that fort. So these Gadkaris were descendants of the military generals who were in charge of these forts. They were not owners of these forts. They were simply like in charge security personnel of these forts. So these security personals and in charge, they were basically soldiers only. They were removed from their service by Kolhapur state in 1844 on British instruction, because British wanted that there should be no Indian army in any of the princely states. So they were also military force only, na? They were soldiers. So Kolhapur, king of Kolhapur, was asked to remove them from their job. The Gadkaris rose in revolt and occupied many forts in Kolhapur region. So basically this revolt took place in Kolhapur region. Similarly, the simmering discontent caused a revolt in Sawantwadi areas. So Sawantwadi basically is the area near Goa. So immediately the revolt also started in the Konkan areas known as Sawantwadi. So that's why it is known as Gadkari and Sawantwadi revolt. So the region was same. That means in charge of forts were thrown out of their job. So ultimately, after the imposition of martial law and meting out brutal punishment to the rebels, the order could be restored in Kolhapur and Sawantwadi region. The most important revolt before the revolt of 1857 was Santhalhul. It took place just 1 year before. So it started in 1855 and continued till 1856. And you know, the great revolt has taken place in 1857. So this revolt took place just before the great revolt of 1857. So it was known as Santhal Hul. Hul in tribal language means revolt. The Santhal Hul, also known as Santhal Revolt, occurred in the regions of present day Jharkhand, Odisha and West Bengal against the British as well as Jamindars. Not only Britishers but also Jamindars, because these tribal peoples used to think that these Jamindars are stooges of British government. Both the Jamindars and Britishers are exploiting us, insulting us, interfering in our religion and administration. So this revolt lasted during 1855 and 56 and was crushed with the help of British army. So when the Jamindari system was introduced in the Bengal Presidency, the British and the Jamindars claimed the traditional Santhal land as their own. So see, in 1793, Jamindars were introduced. So what happened when Jamindars were introduced? So all land was taken or snatched by the British. So those lands which belonged to these tribals were taken from these tribals and given to the Jamindars. So that's why these tribals hated both the Jamindars as well as the British people. The Santhal country extended from Bhagalpur in Odisha, in Bhagalpur in Bihar, to Odisha in south. So this region was called Damineko. Please mind, since this is the last revolt to take place before the Great Revolt, that's why many questions are asked from this. All these questions have been asked. That's why I have included them here. So this region was known as Damineko. Damineko means the skirts of the hill, or you can say foothills. So basically this was the region where tribals lived. Tribals lived on the foothills. The revolt was started in 1855 by two brothers, Sidhu and Kanhu Murmu. The rebellion swept across the entire Santhal. So these Santhals were exploited by landlords, moneylenders and British officers. You already know this. The peasants raised the cry, death to moneylenders. So their basic targets were Jamindars and moneylenders. So death to moneylenders, the police, the civil court officers and landlords. The Santhal rebellion was finally crushed by British troops. So you have to remember who were the leaders, Sidhu and Kanhu Murmu. So about 10,000 Santhals and 1,000 British soldiers. So these many soldiers were not killed in any revolt before. So 1,000 British soldiers were killed. You can see these are British soldiers. And these are tribals fighting with bow and arrow, whereas the Britishers had guns and all other sophisticated weapons. So around 10,000 Santhals and 1,000 British soldiers were killed in an unequal fight between peasants armed with bows and arrows on one side and soldiers equipped with firearms on the other side.